from school. Oh, your kids were gonna watch this?
They're like so starved for, I think, just to know what I do, you know, like they want to come see a class which they haven't done, and they're like, they don't kind of understand when I disappear and go get the talks.
Yeah.
Like, what that looks like, yeah. It's rough. It is.
Okay. Okay, welcome back. We're going to start the second panel here, which is on the topic, still on the topic of, is the Roberts Court pro-business, but we're going to be drilling down into a few subject areas. My name is Charles Corsmo. I'm a business law professor here at Case Western, and there was actually a little confusion when Jonathan asked me to moderate this panel. He said, you know, we're looking at the Supreme Court business law decisions. And I said, oh, well, that, you know, that makes some sense. It's, you know, Chief Justice Strine has been in for almost 3 years now, and it's probably about time to look at, you know, we can talk about Cornerstone and In re Trulia and all these cases. And he said, no, Roberts Court. And I said, oh, you mean the U.S. Supreme Court? I was unaware they did business law cases, really. And then I misheard him again. I thought he said, you know, some of the justices don't even have a substantial business or finance background. And it turns out I did mishear him. He said none of the justices on the court has a substantial business or finance background. And I thought this is a very strange way to run a railroad, but okay. So anyway, I'm a business law guy, not a constitutional law guy. Not a court watcher in general, so this is a great opportunity for me in particular to hear from some truly distinguished scholars of the court. And as I said, this panel is going to dig down a little deeper into individual doctrinal areas, in particular class action litigation and jurisdiction, securities law, and regulation, particularly the question of federal preemption. Of state law regulation. We're going to try to see how the court's decisions in those areas can shed some light on the broader question of whether we can really say the Roberts Court is pro-business in any meaningful sense. I guess I'll introduce in reverse order. I don't know that anything really more needs to be said about Professor Adler at this point, although I'm subject to a tenure vote in a couple of months, so I'll just say he is a magnificent, both as a scholar and as an individual human being. Perhaps only exceeded in his magnificence by our other panelist, Professor Robertson here, who is also a professor of law here at Case Western, and the Laura B. Chisholm Distinguished Research Scholar and director of the Center for Professional Ethics. And she's going to be talking about personal jurisdiction in the Supreme Court. And then Professor Sharkey is the Crystal Eastman Professor of Law at NYU Law School, one of the nation's leading authorities on federal preemption, a prolific author on torts and products liability, administrative law, class actions. Finally, actually, I think we're going to go in reverse order. So we'll start with Professor Malveaux, who is a professor of law at the Columbus School of Law at the Catholic University, and both a distinguished scholar of the Supreme Court as well as a practitioner before the Supreme Court, who actually represented the litigants in Walmart v. Dukes, which is, I believe, is one of the cases she's going to be talking about. So please welcome our panel.
All right, thank you so much for that introduction. I guess I have been outed as a like a plaintiffs-based lawyer at some point in my life, so. So I have been asked to consider the daunting task of trying to discern if the Roberts Court is pro-business when it comes to class actions, trying to make sense of really over a decade of these cases, and it's really a tall order. So what I'd like to do is I've tried to organize them a little bit thematically and tee them up for broader conversation with you today. I think some of them are particularly significant. One was mentioned, the Walmart case, and there are a couple of sort of big cases like that I'll focus on, but some other ones as well. So first of all, this notion of whether or not the Roberts Court is pro-business, it's certainly a mixed bag. Some cases you would say would be pro-business, others are not. Certainly the 5-4 opinions have gotten a lot of attention, the Walmarts, the Comcast, the Concepcions, and so forth. But a number of cases have been unanimous opinions, 9-0 decisions. And the court has actually refrained from granting cert in a variety of cases that actually touch on class action jurisprudence, and so has not, in fact, jumped into the landscape when it could have. So there is, I would say, a legitimate concern about sort of higher obstacles, depending on where you are, I guess, concern versus maybe not so concerned about whether or not class certification has in fact become more difficult, but it's certainly fair to say that class actions have survived despite those higher hurdles. I do think that there's a trend here that the court has moved in when it comes to the notion of court access and making that harder, the access to the courts harder, private enforcement of rights more difficult. And that's taking place not only in the class action context, but in a larger context. And I think some of you had alluded to that earlier in terms of pleadings and so forth. So it's happening certainly within a broader framework. So first of all, how did we get here? Why has the Roberts Court even considered so many class actions in the last 10 years? So the sheer volume of cases around class actions is new. And I think there are a couple of reasons for that. First of all, we have Rule 23F has now allowed interlocutory appeal of class certification decisions, whether denials or grants, since 1998. And so in terms of the pipeline, that interlocutory decision has been sort of ripe for review by the appellate courts. And so that is one reason that we see sort of, more robust jurisprudence when it comes to class actions. And it turns out that has been largely, I'd say, in favor of defendants or has been sort of pro-business. As it turns out, there was a study that was done looking at cases from 1998 to 2012. Of the 23F appeals that were accepted, 70% were from defendants and 30% from plaintiffs. And of the appeals by defendants were successful 70% of the time, and plaintiffs were successful 30% of the time. So that pipeline and Rule 23F interlocutory review has been somewhat helpful to the defense bar. Another reason we're seeing just more class actions, before the court, is because of CAFA. So the Class Action Fairness Act of 2005, as you know, has expanded jurisdiction, federal jurisdiction, for certain types of class actions. And so they have moved, again, that pipeline. We have more that are being considered by the federal courts of appeals as well as the Supreme Court. And I think the Roberts Court is pretty serious about making sure that that federal jurisdiction is protected. So, for example, the first CAFA case that the court looked at, this is the Standard Fire versus Knowles, was a unanimous opinion by the court, made it clear to the named plaintiff that they could not avoid federal jurisdiction by stipulating that the amount in controversy was less than the $5 million threshold. So again, I think there are a number of cases related to CAFA that show that the court is serious about that statute's primary objective, and that is to get interstate cases of national importance into a federal forum. And then finally, why do we see more class actions in front of the Roberts Court? Some have just said it's because of the interest of the justices themselves. Some have said that they have been involved in litigation. Some have even taught civil procedure, so maybe it's something that they like. Some might be motivated by political leanings, whether conservative or liberal, or they may be motivated by just the, as the branch of government, in terms of the stagnation and the stalemate in Congress, and because of the sort of the partisan nature of Congress these days, that nothing much is happening on that front, and that the formal rulemaking committee, the process with the advisory committee, that process is cumbersome and quite slow, taking about 3 to 4 years for a federal rule of civil procedure, in fact, to be amended. And so perhaps the court is filling in a gap there that exists because of all of those reasons. I think one of the interesting things that comes out of looking at the class action jurisprudence from the Roberts Court is to try to figure out what role the court thinks that the class action plays, right? And we can look at that in different ways. And I think the court is looking at the class action as an exception to the general rule that an individual brings their case on his or her own behalf. So typically that the plaintiff is the master of their claim. And because a representative action really runs counter to that general rule, that the court is a protector and has to make sure that there is appropriate, rigorous criteria if you're going to depart from that norm, and to make sure that that departure is justified. So this notion of the class action requiring a very rigorous analysis to make sure that we're in fact going to have a certification would not be unusual and would be appropriate. So the challenge is trying to figure out whether or not the right balance has been struck. Where's the line in terms of rigor? How high should it be? How far have we gone? Have we reached an appropriate level? So certainly, on the one hand, we think about the class action as a procedural asset, promotes efficiency and court access, enabling plaintiffs who have small claims and little resources to call their resources together to jointly challenge what they think might be widespread misconduct in the context of a single lawsuit. And on the other hand, we have the idea that the class action is this procedural anomaly that should be granted only under limited circumstances to really give effect to due process, right? So that rigorous standard allows defendants to adequately defend themselves and avoid being strong-armed into a settlement, and gives class members an opportunity to bring individual claims when it turns out that their interests, in fact, do diverge. And we see that a lot when it comes to monetary relief. So this question about whether or not that rigorous analysis has gone too far and ultimately become a barrier in terms of access to justice that could result in under-enforcement of important statutes and policies coming out of Congress. So obviously we have these two competing norms, two competing narratives that come up in the courts and come up before the court. On the one hand, we have this narrative that we have plaintiffs' lawyers seeking class certification to promote frivolous lawsuits and extract lucrative settlements. And on the other hand, we have this narrative of the defense lawyers fighting class certification to kill meritorious claims and avoid liability, right? So we have those polar opposites. And the idea is really, where are we? Is the pendulum swung in one way or the other too far in terms of these two tropes? And I, you know, venture to say that neither one is really what we're talking about. So the question that comes before the court is the class action a joinder device or is it a regulatory device? And we can see, I think the jurisprudence sort of leads us in, is struggling with that and leads us in the direction of the joinder device over the regulatory one. In general, is it more difficult for cases to be certified as class actions under the Roberts Court? Well, you can think of that in different ways. And so what I tried to do is I thought about this thematically in basically three different areas. One is looking at whether the consideration of the merits of class certification, how much does that happen and for what types of cases? And so I'll be looking at that particularly within the context of securities and civil rights cases. Another way you might think of the question whether or not the Roberts Court is, whether it's more difficult to bring class actions would be looking at arbitration and the court's deference towards the enforceability of arbitration agreements, particularly those that have class action bans embedded in them. And the third way you might look at the question is how does the court rule when it comes to a company making a Rule 68 offer of judgment or a settlement offer that is not to a named plaintiff, which is not accepted, does that function to moot the individual case and ultimately the class action? So those are the three different areas I want to explore for a little bit here. So first of all, the idea of looking at the resolving merits of the class certification stage. So it's a I'd say it's a mixed bag. If we're asking, is it pro-business or not pro-business, pro-plaintiff? Again, those are very crude categorizations, but we'll try to work within that parameter. So in the securities area, it seems to be, I would say, sort of more pro plaintiff, or certainly it's a mix, started off pro plaintiff. Good for shareholders and investors. If we look at Amgen and we look at Halliburton, the first Halliburton case. So Halliburton 1 started off with unanimous decision authored by Chief Justice Roberts, holding that plaintiffs don't have to prove loss causation at the class certification stage. So they're sort of, again, kind of keeping alive the basic presumption in securities class actions. And that case was an unequivocal and unanimous opinion. Amgen, another beneficial case to shareholders and investors, reaffirming the fraud on the market theory, holding that plaintiffs don't have to prove materiality at the class certification stage. So again, sort of protecting the B3 class. And so in the securities area, it's a Halliburton 1 and Amgen, basically telling defendants that they could no longer challenge class certification securities fraud cases on the basis of loss causation of materiality. That switched, that sort of favoring, I'd say, the plaintiff switched to more of a pro-business orientation in Halliburton 2, again, a unanimous opinion by Chief Justice Roberts, that said that defendants could put forth evidence that the alleged misrepresentation did not affect the stock price, so the market price. And so there is the basic presumption survives, but defendants are given an opportunity, in fact, to challenge that presumption and say that there was a lack of price impact. So you could say in this area, the Roberts Court class action jurisprudence has been favorable to investors and shareholders by keeping that basic presumption alive and minimizing the extent to which plaintiffs have to show merits at the class certification stage. But the company, too, has the opportunity to rebut that presumption. And I'd say it's not really clear whether that this line of cases really has anything a lot to say about other areas in terms of class action jurisprudence. So I'd say it's a different story when we get to the civil rights context, when we look at the examination of merits at the class certification stage. And of course, this is where the Walmart case is somewhat central. You may recall in the Walmart case that the issue there was at the outset that the court decertified the case because it said the commonality was not satisfied under Rule 23A2. This was a 5-4 decision, so clearly a controversial, at least this portion of the decision was a controversial one. This was authored by Scalia and raised the bar for commonality, arguably one of the easiest criteria for class certification. Supposed to be one single question, one single common question should suffice, and the court said that that wasn't the case here. So not surprisingly, what the court did, it reiterated the importance of having a rigorous analysis when it comes to class certification and looking at the merits when they overlap with the class certification determination, and that the plaintiffs had the burden of proving that the Rule 23 criteria were met. What was surprising, at least to a number of people, myself included, was just the idea that now that the commonality bar had been raised, so that plaintiffs had to offer significant proof that Walmart had operated under a general policy of discrimination in order to satisfy that low threshold, that commonality threshold, that had not seen that in the Title VII jurisprudence before, and that has now been applied not only in the Title VII context, but in those outside of Title VII. So what's the impact of Walmart? Certainly there was a lot of buzz. There's been a tremendous, I think, hundreds of law review articles by professors who've written in this area. What are the implications of this highly controversial opinion? And I'd say the implications are really varied. On the one hand, the case, I would say, has had little impact on employment discrimination class actions. Certainly because of the size and scope of Walmart itself. You can imagine the class is 1.5 million women who are challenging alleged gender discrimination nationwide. So not a lot of cases look like that. So they're clearly pushing the envelope in terms of the outer bounds of what you could think holds a case together to satisfy commonality. So as a result, smaller cases, plaintiffs' lawyers representing folks in employment discrimination cases are bringing smaller claims. They're regionally based, and those have been more successful. If they're geographically limited. And so you're creating a stronger nexus between the decision maker and the adverse employment action that's being challenged. Other ways plaintiff's counsel has adjusted, there are a variety of things that have happened. Cases have been successful in terms of issue certification under 23 CF, C4, creating subclasses, defining the class more narrowly, distinguishing Walmart, and then bringing cases in state court. So all of those things are going on. Which would suggest that the impact has not been as large as people might have anticipated. On the flip side, you could say that there has been some significant impact, and that's certainly in the area where the case looks a lot like Walmart. So Walmart is different in terms of its, you know, it's very large and so forth, but not so different in terms of the theory that it was relying on, the notion that excessive subjectivity was a vehicle for discrimination. And so to the extent that the cases with identical theories have not fared well under Walmart since then. And that's true within Title VII context and even outside of the Title VII context. I will say that that is tempered by circuit court decisions that have overturned denials of class certification that deal with some discretion. So it's not as if there are cases that involving discretionary calls are completely off the table, quite the contrary. So the Seventh Circuit, for example, Posner case, held that local managers who exercise discretion on the ground, but who are doing that pursuant to a very particular policy at the, you know, at the nationwide level or at headquarters, those are surviving commonality. Or if it turns out, again, there's a case out of the Fourth Circuit where the high level managers themselves, if they are the ones who in fact are exercising that discretion, then they too are surviving commonality. And so it's not as if there is no discretionary. It's not as if the discretionary theory is not, that it's impossible for it to be certified as a class action. So I think it's clear, certainly, that Walmart has not eliminated class actions, even those involving discretionary behavior. But it's important not to underestimate the impact of front-loading that inquiry, the merits inquiry, at the class certification stage. So that leads to higher costs in terms of discovery, in terms of delay, and so forth. Does deter some cases from, in fact, being filed at all. So there's a study that came out that said employment discrimination cases, the filings of those class actions have been on the wane post-Walmart. And I'd also add that the Walmart is tempered by Tyson Foods, which allowed representative or aggregate proof to be used, a sampling to be used in a class action, despite the language, Scalia's language, coming out of Walmart against a trial by formula. So turning to arbitration, I think in that area, it's more easy to say that there is a pro-business leaning in that direction here. So the court's preference for the enforceability of arbitration agreements, particularly those that have embedded class action bans. So the court is very deferential to the enforcement of arbitration agreements, and businesses are using arbitration agreements and class action bans more and more, I think, as a result of that. So there's certainly been a significant increase in the use of arbitration agreements. There was a 2000 study that came out that found at least one out of five of all employees are subject to a mandatory arbitration clause. Now, the lower courts are divided on to what extent those contracts or those arbitration agreements are contracts of adhesion and are looking at the specific parameters, the specific terms to figure out whether or not they're enforceable. The Supreme Court, I would say, I can't think of a case that it hasn't enforced an arbitration agreement in certain areas, in every manner of contract, and in every area of law. So the big cases, of course, are going to be AT&T versus Concepcion and Italian Colors. So Concepcion telling us that the Federal Arbitration Act preempts state law that seems contrary to the contrary to the goals of the FAA, even if it is that the state is trying to establish guidelines or criteria for unconscionability, saying if there's a class action ban under certain circumstances that we think that it is unconscionable. The court has rejected that and said the FAA preempted California's law in Concepcion. In that case, DirecTV has bolstered that conclusion. And American Express versus Italian Colors is another good example where the court, I think, has gone even further in terms of permitting arbitration agreements that foreclose class actions. And there, what's interesting about that case is that the plaintiffs had established, the court said that the arbitration, the class action waiver was enforceable even where the plaintiffs had established that they would not have been able to pursue their case outside of the context of some kind of cost-sharing arrangement or some sort of collective action. It looked like the cost of an expert was in the several hundred thousands, maybe even exceeded a million. So it made it irrational or impossible for individuals to, in fact, pursue the antitrust claims that they were making. And even in that context, the court said that that the arbitration agreement was enforceable. And so that was a Scalia decision that said even if plaintiffs were had proved that it was economically infeasible to bring the case as an individual arbitration, that agreement, the arbitration agreement, still forbid them from bringing the case as a class action. Certainly, given the proliferation of class action arbitration waivers in business agreements, consumer agreements, employment agreements, and so forth, I think the impact of Italian Colors and Concepcion is going to be pretty significant, right? That language is broad and can be applied to various federal statutes beyond the antitrust claims. The last area that I've looked at, this notion of the court's treatment of what impact would an offer, a Rule 68 offer of judgment or a settlement offer, have on the viability of a class action. If you make that offer to an individual a named representative, and they don't accept that offer, could that still moot the individual case and ultimately the class action itself? It started off a little rocky, the court in the Genesis Healthcare Corporation versus Symtec, and ultimately I think got clarified in Campbell Ewald, where the court said that an unaccepted Rule 68 offer of judgment or unaccepted settlement offer does not moot the plaintiff's claim or the class action itself. So it disallowed a company to defeat a class action by mooting the putative class representative's individual claim. So I would say that plaintiff's victory is sort of tempered by this language in the opinion in terms of what the court did not decide. It said that it didn't decide whether or not the result would be different if the defendant deposited the full amount of the plaintiff's individual claim in an account, and if the judge then entered a judgment for the plaintiff, then maybe that would do it. So sort of, we haven't heard the latest of the mootness issue, but that in fact has been teed up already by some circuit courts below who in fact have already started to make rulings in that area. So I'll just stop here and say that it's been interesting to think about this because I think the class action rulings, and there have been quite a few of them, take place within the context of a broader discussion or a broader orientation that the court is displaying when it comes to access to the courts, when it comes to private enforcement of substantive rights. Folks have mentioned Twombly and Iqbal as well. We see similar types of things happening in different directions. And so I think that cumulative effect is something that is worth taking a look at, whether it's discovery or pleadings or class actions and so forth. What we see is a shift in terms of merits being considered front-loading at the beginning of the litigation, and not ultimately getting to the end, whether it's summary judgment or even ultimately getting to a jury trial. So we know that procedural cases and procedure in general, we have to balance these two competing interests. There's, you know, justice on the one hand and efficiency on the other, which is really captured by Rule 1 of the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. And figuring out the right balance, I think, is a tricky enterprise, and I think the court is still trying to get that balance right. So that's it.
Good morning. I want to thank Jonathan Adler for the invitation to speak here today. And Business in the Roberts Court, I just received my copy of the book. I'm not one of the original authors, but I must confess, I looked quickly to the index and my name is in the index. So page 218, I appear in this book. So now I will buy it for all of my friends, family, et cetera. I'm quite thrilled to have seen this. And I didn't know that before coming today. So I will be a strong proselytizer for purchasing.
There's a discount code on the form.
Excellent. Here's what I want to talk about, and it's helped because in the earlier panel, there were allusions to two lines of cases that I'm very interested in. So there was some reference made by both Jonathan and Jim to federal preemption cases, particularly tort cases. So that's the issue where there have been a series of cases, and the issue it arises under multiple different statutes, but the basic idea is, should the federal statute or regulation preempt or oust either state positive law regulation or what I'm most interested in, which is state tort law, common law. So the U.S. Supreme Court, this was a previous issue about whether tort law even is akin to regulatory law, but the court resolved that issue. So now the issue is always becomes, what is the clash between, say, a state law, state common law failure to warn claim against a drug manufacturer when the FDA has approved the drug, right? That would be a preemption case. And then Karen Harned mentioned really interesting, she alluded quickly at least to a really interesting administrative law line of cases. She alluded to what's known as Chevron deference. Chevron deference is the deference that's given to an administrative agency when interpreting a statute. I'm going to add, but I'm going to put it under this rubric of agency deference line of cases. There's a line, there's a different type of deference called AUER, spelled A-U-E-R deference. And this is deference to an administrative agency's interpretation of its own regulation. But they're both about how much deference or leeway are you going to give to the administrative agency. And what I want to suggest is the following. Each of these lines of cases has been pitted in this kind of debate that some of us find, I think I agree that some of this tallying up of numbers is less interesting, although I have to say I'm a broadly speaking, unique for a law professor in that I have studied law and economics, done empirical work, et cetera. So it's not because I dismiss the utility of that kind of work. It's just certain lines of jurisprudence, I think, are much more interesting, actually, when you delve in a little bit more deeply beneath the numbers. But each of these lines have been held up, namely preemption will favor business interests, right? Because it's going to get out tort litigation that seems to be a thorn in the side of business interests. And the retreat from these doctrines of agency deference will also benefit business interests, broadly speaking. In fact, Karen, you gave some great terminology that I wrote down while you were speaking, where you said that it's about time to start dealing with agencies run wild, right? Law professors are always thinking about, you know, provocative titles for law review articles, and that one, agencies run wild. I haven't seen it before, but it kind of, you know, other scholars have written kind of the same point, but they've been talking about reining in the administrative state. That's, you know, a little more, that's like as wild as law professors' imagination runs. But there are, more seriously, right, there is a strain. She alluded to Chief Justice Roberts in his dissent in a case called City of Arlington. And what's interesting to me is there's this intriguing language about the behemoth administrative state. So I'm going to just quote. He talks about the danger posed by the growing power, and this is the part I like. It involves hundreds hundreds of federal agencies poking into every nook and cranny of daily life. That sounds pretty bad. It's followed by the late Justice Scalia, similarly in a dissent, had talked about too many important decisions of the federal government are made nowadays by unelected agency officials exercising broad lawmaking authority rather than by the people's representatives in Congress. And Justice Thomas really has unleashed, I think, the broadest attack and the most vitriolic kind of rhetoric against the encroachment of the administrative state. He writes in a recent 2015 concurrence in a case called Perez versus Mortgage Bankers Association that the expansion of the administrative state, this part I'm not quoting, has been fueled by, quote, a misguided belief that bureaucrats might more effectively govern the country than the American people. So there is this sense among some of the justices that agencies, you know, we could just sum all of that up, agencies running wild, and what should we do about it? So there's been some, there have been certain recent cases that have maybe signaled, and Karen interestingly said, let's see what the future holds here, but may have signaled some form of a retreat from giving Chevron deference to agencies in interpreting statutes, and also much rumbling skepticism, and that's what I want to focus on here, on this our doctrine, this idea of giving deference to agencies for interpreting their own regulations. And interestingly, right, this is why it becomes to me very interesting that you can't do this either by saying wins, losses, or saying, you know, Justice Scalia, yes, no, because there's an evolution of doctrine here. So Justice Scalia wrote it. He was the author of the decision in 1997. 16 years later, this is what he says in partial dissent in Decker about this doctrine, right? He says it's a, quote, dangerous permission slip for the arrogation of power. And then he goes further, right? I've got to quote this language because it just doesn't get so good that the, you know, we're going to go back to 17th century England and the threat of king and parliament to understand what kind of threat this doctrine, our, is, which, by the way, 16 years ago, as I mentioned, he authored and created, or I mean, he didn't create it. He was extending it from prior precedent. So he says, quote, when the legislative and executive powers are united in the same person, there can be no liberty because apprehensions may arise lest the same monarch or Senate should enact tyrannical laws to execute them in a tyrannical manner, right? You might never have heard of our, but you should look it up and you should think about it, because this is like the, we're getting back to like the Tudor monarchy, right, in England, and we need to have some form of separation of power. So the more mundane legalistic point that's being made here is what's wrong with our deference? And by the way, as we know, Scalia wasn't ready to abandon Chevron deference. So what's different? The idea is the agency promulgates the regulation. They're the lawmaker, and then they're given this enormous deference to interpret and enforce. It's all happening, all this tyrannical power, all in one entity, and that's what must be resisted. Now, it wasn't just Scalia coming to this conclusion. The Chief Justice made it plain in a separate concurrence in Decker that he would welcome the opportunity to revisit our, and Justice Alito likewise talked about how he was concerned about the aggrandizement of power in administrative agencies, et cetera. So there's this interesting to me thing going on over here with respect to our deference that at first glance, I guess, one would put in the frame of this conference as this is really good for businesses, or at least, you know, Karen, again, I like the terminology. You said something like less is more in terms of governmental regulation. So we're going to not want to be giving any kind of power or authority over to the administrative state. But now enter the preemption doctrine. We'll come back to whether that's really a full picture with respect to our deference. In the preemption cases, there were a couple of these cases were mentioned. Wyeth versus Levine was mentioned earlier. Wyeth versus Levine is a case against a drug manufacturer. There was a failure to warn claim, a state tort claim brought, and the manufacturer tried to say that there should be federal preemption because the FDA had approved this brand name drug. And as was mentioned also earlier, this is a case in which the quote unquote conservative view in favor of preemption loses, right? The court, the majority opinion, suggests that you can have a common law tort suit. What's interesting to me in that case is that Justice Alito writes a dissent that's joined by both the Chief Justice and the late Justice Scalia. And part of their dissent in that case, and I'm going to read just a part that I find particularly interesting, is that they accuse the majority there of, quote, turning a common law tort suit into a frontal assault, that's the language they use, on the FDA's regulatory regime for drug labeling. A frontal assault. How do they determine this? They look and they rely very heavily on the brief that's filed by the United States representing the FDA. They chastise the majority for not giving deference, for not, quote, relying on the FDA's explanation of its own regulatory purposes. So that's interesting to me because, you know, it suggests that there's a tension or a schism underlying this resistance of the administrative state and at least kind of having a pro-preemption position in some of these FDA-type cases. Very interesting is Justice Thomas's position there. And here, partly because I don't want to have too much, we don't have general agreement across the board by any means, but I want to try to be as provocative as I can. Jim, you mentioned that Justice Thomas is out of the business of implied preemption, and I think you were thinking about this concurrence in Wyeth, which is very striking. He doesn't join with his quote-unquote conservative brethren. He instead concurs, believes, joins the majority, saying we can have this frontal attack on the FDA, and his reason is because he does not believe in, quote, relying on the musings about goals or intentions of agencies, right? He said this isn't statutory text, this is just judges making it up, and worse, it's relying on agencies. So it looks like he's at least being somewhat consistent, right, in terms of, well, if I want to resist the behemoth administrative state, I'm going to have to, you know, take my hits, so to speak, even if I wouldn't in general otherwise necessarily be championing state tort law. But, and here's maybe where I just disagree a little bit, is that what's puzzling is Thomas then comes back after Wyeth. And actually, it was interesting. I think it was David Savage in the Washington Post wrote an article called Justice Thomas, Supreme Liberal, right? So I guess you could put like Rose and Supreme Inc. And then this moment, people were thinking at the time, wow, we've got him as this even greater supporter than Justice Stevens, because Justice Stevens was going to be potentially giving deference to agencies. So here, who at that time wanted preemption. But lo and behold, after Wyeth, there are two cases that I think are very important that are further drug preemption cases. They have to do with generic drug manufacturers, not brand names, so there's some distinguishing features. But Justice Thomas actually writes the decision in the first of them, called Pliva versus Mensing, which is in 2011, and then there's a follow-up case called Mutual Pharmaceutical Company versus Bartlett in 2013. So note, too, that we're talking now about developments in preemption almost contemporaneous with those developments I was talking about before, about rescinding deference to agencies. And in Pliva, what's very curious is there's this, what I call the puzzling persistence of our deference. Why do I say that? In that case, Justice Thomas writes in favor of implied preemption. So that's where I think what you meant to say is he's out of the business of implied conflict preemption. But he's very much in the business of implied, what's called possibility preemption. So basically what he decides in this case is that generic drug manufacturers, unlike brand names, can't change their label when new risk evidence comes to life, because in that way, their label wouldn't be the same any longer as the brand name. Okay, so it's a little bit of a quirk of the statutory and regulatory system. But what's curious to me is instead of just saying, let's rely on the text of the statute, which is the Hatch-Waxman Act or amendments to the FDCA, and the regulatory text, what does he do? He defers to the FDA's interpretation of its own regulation. He not only invokes our, it's invoked repeatedly in that case. And I would argue at this moment, the impossibility preemption line kind of rests on our deference as one of its kind of pillars. And then in the subsequent case, Bartlett, the court court doesn't invoke our, but they cite mensing to the exact place where our deference is invoked, and they use this language saying, this is a Leto writing, saying that they're relying on the drug regulation, quote, as interpreted by the FDA. So it's still there, and my argument would be like, here's a potential clash. And what I found interesting in what being invited to this symposium, I'd thought about these things before, has allowed me the opportunity to begin to explore, is I find it fascinating to now dig in, and I kind of previewed this by the question that I had to Karen during her panel, but to dig in a bit and see what was the quote unquote business community, which as I said, I thought it would be interesting just to define in this area as entities like Chamber of Commerce, like NFIB, like National Association of Manufacturers, like really interesting to me, the group called PhRMA, which is the Pharmaceutical Research and Manufacturers of America, because they care very much about FDA preemption, and they also have weighed in on this line of administrative law cases. So here's what I find really interesting. Certain business groups, right, however we're going to define business, but they're filing briefs saying we represent this segment of the business community, when it comes to the our deference, have been on both sides, right? In a case where it would support them to say, give deference to the agency because they like the result that comes, they will invoke it. And in cases not, they will not. Certain of the groups, the Chamber of Commerce coming to mind, NFIB coming to mind, actually resist that. And they push quite a consistent approach towards the court. Even in a case, Decker comes to mind, where the Chamber actually agreed with the position of the EPA and could have argued in favor of getting some kind of deference, giving some kind of deference, resisted that. Very interesting to me that PhRMA, for whatever reason, seems to be filing briefs in the administrative law line saying don't give agency deference, but quite comfortable arguing for it in the FDA preemption line of cases. So, what does this tell us? I actually think I'm at the beginnings. I'm trying to probe and do some more analysis and also talk to people. It was a great opportunity to hear Karen speak and be able to hear a little bit about the sort of strategic decisions. There are some groups. So to my mind, it's not just the idea that there are some groups that are repeat players before the court, and obviously they have a strategic interest. There's some groups that would be thinking about these two lines of jurisprudence and other groups that wouldn't. I think the product liability associations, for example, who care very much about preemption cases, don't care so much about administrative deference. I think they should, because it's a pillar that's going to be affecting preemption type cases. But some of these groups, I think, are more akin to the U.S. Supreme Court, at least, in terms of looking at these lines of potentially colliding lines of jurisprudence and having to figure out a way to reconcile them. And I find that very fascinating. Final point that I'll make, because I'm I find as a descriptive matter, it's kind of interesting to see that and to see what's going on in terms of both the groups representing various elements of the business community and the court evolving towards certain positions. My own take is a normative matter that would bridge this divide, and this is what actually is referred to on page 218 of the book, so I was happy to see that something that it wasn't like, there could have been some disparaging comment about something, but it was actually this model that I've put forward called the agency reference view in preemption, whereby I've argued that courts should actually take a look, but not give Chevron type deference, should give a harder look scrutiny to input from the agency in preemption. I've also now developed a similar kind of model for what I think should go on in the Chevron deference, our deference space. Namely, I think there's certain forms of retreat that try to be taking the position that we should get agencies out of the equation. And my approach instead would say that there should be heightened judicial scrutiny over what's happening in the agency sphere. And what's interesting to me, at least, about that is not so much that it's neutral, but maybe in the terms in which the debate thus far about the business court, the Roberts as business court has played out, it is in that everyone in the sphere looking at the retrenchment of agency deference seems to applaud this as favoring businesses and being very, very anti-regulatory, right? If you give a hard look to what agencies are doing in the regulatory field, it might mean you don't accept certain regulations because they're not plausibly justified as having net benefit, et cetera. So it's seen as being pro-business. If you take that same heightened scrutiny over in preemption, what does it mean? It means when an agency's pushing preemption, like the agency was in Wyeth, the court gives a hard look to that and tries to think about what the empirical basis for its position is, and that actually works in the opposite direction. And maybe, I mean, this would be too much to wish for, but maybe the court is actually groping towards a position that would have some kind of conceptual or theoretical unity across those spheres. And that would be, to me, very exciting. Thank you very much.
So I'm Cassandra Robertson, and again, thank you to Jonathan for including me on this panel. I'm going to talk today about the Roberts Court's approach to personal jurisdiction and procedure a little more broadly, which really infuses all of the other subject areas that you've heard about today. The first thing I would note is that it's really a big deal that we can talk about the Roberts Court's approach to personal jurisdiction, because for nearly a quarter of a century, from 1987 until 2011, the Supreme Court declined to hear any cases relating to personal jurisdiction. Of course, this didn't mean that the issues weren't being litigated. They certainly were. And for, you know, nearly 25 years, the circuit courts of appeals really developed their own jurisdictional doctrine that for the most part was pretty coherent, with a few circuit splits on some issues, but broad levels of agreement. So the court's inattention to personal jurisdiction changed between 2011 and 2014, when the court granted four separate personal jurisdiction cases. So went from not hearing any for nearly 25 years to hearing four in a very short period of time. In each of those cases, the court narrowed personal jurisdiction doctrine to some degree, to varying degrees between the cases. But one commonality was that in each of the cases, the defendant had argued that it couldn't be subject to personal jurisdiction in the state where it had been sued. And ultimately, the Supreme Court agreed. So the decisions, in effect, really were defendant-friendly. In each of those cases, the defendant had objected to being hailed into the plaintiff's forum choice, and in each of those cases, they won. So to the extent that business interests are often viewed as being largely synonymous with defendant interests more broadly, I think the defendants, the decisions can reasonably be considered to be protective of business interests as a whole. But as with the larger theme of the book, I would argue that there's more to the story in the jurisdictional area. So the most influential of these cases, and the one that really disrupted practice the most, is Daimler versus Bowman. And it really is impossible to overstate just how much this case disrupted personal jurisdiction. The general framework for jurisdiction, for those of you who don't litigate, or it's been a little while since you were a first-year law student, there's two types of personal jurisdiction. General jurisdiction is dispute-blind jurisdiction. So the defendant can be sued in this forum for any matter, whether it's related to the forum or not. And then specific jurisdiction is not dispute blind. Specific jurisdiction requires that there be some connection to the particular forum. The test for specific jurisdiction is the minimum contacts test outlined by International Shoe, that is largely still intact. But the test for general jurisdiction that the circuit courts had adopted, that every first-year law student learned for 25 years, was this continuous and systematic test. That the defendant, if the defendant had continuous and systematic contacts in the jurisdiction, as long as those contacts are relatively substantial, then the defendant could be sued in that forum for any case, regardless of its relationship to that forum. The general jurisdiction test, as I said, was largely developed by the circuits, but it was not controversial, right? All of the circuits agreed. All of them applied this test. Every first-year casebook described the test. And then Daimler comes down in January of 2014, right at the time when I'm teaching personal jurisdiction to my civil procedure students. And I had to tell them, right, everything in the casebook between pages 67 and 75, just ignore that. It's all different now. They were thrilled, of course, to hear that. they'd already read it, so they weren't that thrilled. So what happened here, and why did it matter so much? Essentially, the court made nationwide jurisdiction much harder to achieve. So under the old continuous and systematic test, there'd be no question, right, that Walmart could be subject to personal jurisdiction in all 50 states. It operated a store in every state. Operating a retail store is the kind of continuous and systematic contact that every circuit had held is sufficient for general jurisdiction. Not really controversial. In 2011, a little bit before the court decided Daimler, it might have set off a couple of flares that, you know, something different was going on. In the case of Goodyear versus Brown, in that case, that was the first time that the court kind of limited the continuous and systematic language that had been applied by the lower courts. But it did so in a way that wasn't particularly controversial yet. In Goodyear versus Brown, the question was whether stream of commerce actions could fit in with general jurisdiction. So Goodyear's tires might flow through the stream of commerce to certain jurisdictions. They might do that with some regularity, even with, you know, a fair amount of substantial business being done. Would that be enough to support general jurisdiction when their products are simply ending up, albeit regularly, in a particular jurisdiction? The court in Goodyear unanimously says no. They, for the first time, use this at-home language and emphasize that the defendant was not at home in the forum. So the court said in Goodyear, it's not just any continuous and systematic contact that matters. It's contact that's so continuous and systematic that the defendant can fairly be said to be at home in the forum. So again, this wasn't controversial. Most of the circuits had already moved in that direction. So really, the court was kind of shutting down an outlier case out of the Ninth Circuit. And nobody really thought that, you know, with a defendant like Walmart or Home Depot or some that does business in every state, that it would change for them, right? If somebody is operating a store in the state, can't they fairly be said to be at home? But then in the Daimler case, the court takes it a significant step further. The Daimler case arose out of issues in Argentina. The plaintiffs in the case were Argentinian plaintiffs who were suing Daimler over actions taken during Argentina's dirty war. The plaintiffs sued in California, which by all accounts had no real connection to the dispute. The dispute is about what happened in Argentina. But California was a favorable forum for the plaintiffs. And importantly, this is where Mercedes-Benz USA had a regional office. So the plaintiffs argued two things. They argued that Mercedes's contacts with their regional office there should be imputed to the parent corporation, to Daimler. And then that would make MBUSA also subject to general personal jurisdiction in the state. So the question that most onlookers expected the court to answer then was whether the contacts of a subsidiary corporation could be fairly imputed to the parent corporation for purposes of personal jurisdiction. That question was ripe for a decision. The circuits were reaching varying opinions on it. It was teed up perfectly for a decision. There was a lot of amicus support for answering that question. The Chamber of Commerce filed an amicus brief saying, please, please give us a decision on this imputation of contacts based on corporate structure. But interestingly, the court surprised everybody, completely sidestepped that issue, and instead held that the lower courts and every single first-year casebook was misstating the rules of general jurisdiction. So the court reiterated its at-home language that it had first discussed in Goodyear, but this time it says, except in the most unusual of circumstances, a corporate defendant is going to be at home only in the locations where it's domiciled. So only its headquarters, corporate headquarters, and state of incorporation, maximum of two states, where it's going to be at home. Everywhere else, there will be no general jurisdiction. So the court actually said, even if Mercedes-Benz's contacts could be imputed to Daimler, which they intentionally did not decide, and said, even if we assume that they can be, having a regional office in California is not enough for general jurisdiction. It needs to be some connection with the forum. So this really changed everything. In cases all over the country where the defendants hadn't even bothered to challenge jurisdiction, they're suddenly able to raise personal jurisdiction defenses. And for those of you who do litigate or were recently a first-year law student and remember, right, how easy it is to waive the personal jurisdiction defense. It's one of those disfavored defenses that has to be raised very early on in the litigation or it's waived. So courts had to struggle with this question. If a case has been sitting there for several years through, you know, multiple rounds of motion practice, motions for summary judgment, et cetera, may the defendant raise this challenge at this point? And interestingly, for the most part, courts did accept these late coming challenges, holding that the court's change in the law was so unpredictable that the defendant couldn't have been expected to raise the issue earlier. So for a defendant like Walmart, it would have been considered actually frivolous to challenge personal jurisdiction in a state where they had a store. But now, not only is it no longer frivolous to raise that challenge, it would be a winning argument for Walmart anywhere outside of Arkansas or Delaware. So was the decision favorable to business? Yes and no, right? It has a very profound effect on a number of substantive areas and certainly makes some cases harder. We've talked a little bit today already about class actions. This is a big area that is made substantially more difficult. Nationwide class actions typically involve plaintiffs, right, from all 50 states. So some of the plaintiff's claims by the nature of a nationwide class action are necessarily going to be unrelated to the forum where the case is pending. So it becomes very difficult to bring a nationwide class action anywhere outside of the corporation's domicile. And then even harder, right, if the class action is proceeding against multiple defendants. So maybe you have an overall product manufacturer, like a car manufacturer, as well as the manufacturer of a component part, like maybe the airbag manufacturer. Then in some cases, it's just impossible to maintain a nationwide class action because there's no single forum where the multiple defendants are all at home, unless you get lucky and they're all incorporated in Delaware, maybe. But for a lot of cases, the courts have been kicking them out, making it impossible for the plaintiffs to sustain a class action. I have argued along with my co-author that perhaps the specific jurisdiction, forum-linked jurisdiction, could and should be broadened to accommodate some of those class actions. But again, I think the circuits have not historically done that. And the Supreme Court certainly has not broadened jurisdiction in this way. So the courts are dismissing a number of these class actions. But at the same time, right, there's always more to the story. And these decisions have also created some new problems for businesses. The biggest issue currently working its way up now in multiple courts all at once is the question of personal jurisdiction based on a company's registration to do business in state, right? The appointment of a registered agent for service of process. This was a huge issue, you know, 120 years ago, right? Everybody was litigating this and they really haven't since. Until now, because they didn't need to, right? They had general jurisdiction to the extent that a business was doing continuous and systematic business in the state. Without that, now you're seeing a lot of attempts to go back to these old registration statutes and talk about whether or not they can support general jurisdiction. We don't have a clear answer, obviously, on where this is going to go. But the fact that the question is even being litigated and being litigated in so many courts on so many fronts at the current time is at a minimum requiring a huge amount of time and energy and money to litigate those issues. Right now, not very many states actually claim the ability to subject businesses to general jurisdiction based on the appointment of a registered agent. But one of the problems here is the issue is so ancient that it's not even entirely clear in some cases what the position of a particular state is. At least one, Pennsylvania, does have a registration statute that specifically conditions registration on the consent to jurisdiction. And, you know, others may take that approach as well. So many observers expect the court to rule against this attempted exercise of jurisdiction, but you know, certainly for the moment, it's causing a massive litigation effort. And I'm a little skeptical, actually, that the court necessarily will rule against that exercise of jurisdiction. So looking at what maybe motivates the court's rulings in this area, I think it's very clear that it's not a business-friendly effort per se, right? Some of the impact may be favorable to businesses, but if it were the motivation, I think the court would have taken the chamber's invitation, right, to decide the question based on imputed contacts of a subsidiary corporation. That was what the entire business community wanted the court to answer. That would have been a much easier way out of this litigation, wouldn't have opened up all these other fronts. Instead, the court's approach has been a bit more opaque, but it has, I think, reiterated certain underlying values and doctrinal commitments. And one of those is that it's pretty clear that the court is not afraid to undo decades of legal doctrine developed in the courts of appeals. The courts of appeals had been in broad agreement about the scope of general jurisdiction, but the court did not feel beholden to that doctrine even a little bit, and was really not afraid to disrupt the status quo, even at really a fairly substantial litigation cost. Second, and I think importantly here, the court has been very skeptical of plaintiffs' efforts to forum shop, and particularly skeptical in cases that involve transnational litigation. I think it's no surprise that three out of the four cases involving personal jurisdiction that the court took were transnational cases. They involved parties from multiple nations, and usually events that took place outside of the United States. Historically, the United States and particularly certain states within the U.S. have served as a magnet forum, attracting cases from around the globe. And in Daimler especially, the court expressed a great deal of concern about the potential foreign relations problems that could arise from trying to serve as a forum for disputes that properly belong in the courts of other nations. Related to that, but not entirely overlapping with it, is the court, I think, has really demonstrated a commitment to geographical formalism and respect for state boundaries. Some of this is deference to the federal system, but some of it also, I think, is something more. I think it's a true commitment to formalism, predictability, and territorial authority. So it's less clear to me how this would cut for the states that do condition business registration on consent to jurisdiction. I wouldn't be shocked if the court concluded that it was within the state's power to do so. I think for a lot of reasons, it's probably not within the state's interest to do so, and certainly Delaware has so held. But for those states who do try to exercise this power, I'm less certain that the court would shut it down. Again, it goes back to much of the 19th century case law and a much older emphasis on territoriality, but I think it could be in keeping with the Roberts Court's approach to personal jurisdiction. And then finally, another issue that I would highlight that's often missing from the equation of business interests with defendants' interests is I think that we overlook sometimes the issues that businesses face as plaintiffs. Especially when it comes to personal jurisdiction, I think this perspective really matters and has been overlooked to some degree. So when we are looking at employment cases, tort cases, class actions, it's true businesses are very often the defendants. But plaintiffs do, businesses do act as plaintiffs in a great number of cases that can be very, very important to them, especially actions to protect their intellectual property. So to the extent that the court has reduced plaintiffs' forum choice, that's going to affect businesses as well and will narrow their options about where they can file suit and how they can, for example, protect their IP rights. And again, the confluence of transnational litigation and reduced forum choice can work together to create some real problems, especially when the parties who are allegedly infringing those IP rights are domiciled abroad. So there were a couple of recent cases involving Gucci and Tiffany & Co., which are both luxury brands who were concerned about their products being counterfeited. Typically, those counterfeit products would be manufactured abroad and then sold within the United States over the internet. So Gucci purses, Tiffany jewelry, there were a great deal of counterfeit goods being sold over the internet. In this case, the criminal infringers were located in China and probably beyond the effective reach of the plaintiffs. But the money that they were earning through the U.S. sales of these infringing products could actually be traced pretty easily and traced back to particular accounts in the Bank of China. So Gucci and Tiffany both tried to go after asset freezes, asking the Bank of China to freeze those assets so that at least the defendants wouldn't benefit from the sale of these counterfeit goods. And prior to Daimler, it would have been a no-brainer to get a New York court to order that kind of an asset freeze, right? The Bank of China is a worldwide corporation. They have a very large office in New York City. You know, historically, it would have been no problem then to exercise jurisdiction over them in New York. But after Daimler, right, the Bank of China could successfully argue that the court lacked general jurisdiction over them because they're not at home in New York, right? They are domiciled and have their headquarters in China only. The Second Circuit agreed with that argument. That was one of the cases where the motion to dismiss for lack of personal jurisdiction came up pretty late in the litigation. The Second Circuit had to return it for additional briefing about the effect of Daimler, and ultimately held that there was no general jurisdiction. After a few more rounds of wrangling, the court did hold that there were enough forum-linked events happening, that the Bank of China was doing enough linked to the litigation in the state of Ohio, that specific jurisdiction was appropriate. But that has been a controversial decision. Not all circuits have followed it. Certainly, it has been subject to some criticism. So in conclusion, I would say that the effect of the court's personal jurisdiction doctrine is still developing. It's hard to say exactly what the effect on business will be in the long run until we have answers to some of these questions, like the role now of specific jurisdiction and what will happen with registration-based jurisdiction. But it's certainly not an easy or a reflexive answer. And I think at a minimum, it's fairly clear that what's motivating the court here is not business interests per se, but is some of these other commitments doctrinally and theoretically. Thank you.
It occurs to me that in my haste to butter up Professor Adler before my tenure vote, I neglected to mention why he's on this panel in the first place. Todd Henderson had to back out at the last minute, so Jonathan's pinch hitting on short notice to discuss a little bit of the securities law jurisprudence of the Roberts course.
What I was going to say, I was going to get up here and say that I have two confessions. The first is that I'm not Todd Henderson, and secondly, that I lack both his securities law expertise and sartorial mastery, but I do have the benefit of being able to draw on a chapter that Adam Pritchard wrote for the Business in the Roberts Court book, and I want to say just make a few observations based largely on Adam's work. And I, for those that are interested in securities law, I highly recommend his chapter, both for its discussion of contemporary doctrine, but also the historical sensibility he brings to this area of the law. One of the observations that Adam begins with, which is interesting, is that the number of securities law cases that the Roberts Court has is taken or has taken is significant. During the Rehnquist court, during the Rehnquist court, the Supreme Court took about one securities law case per year on average. The rate of securities law cases in the Roberts court has doubled, about two cases per year. And that's really very interesting, but it's also kind of curious. And it's curious for a couple of reasons. One is that since the departure of Justice Powell, there is no member of the court that has any particular expertise or experience having worked in securities law. Justice Powell had worked had done significant work in securities law in private practice. Prior to Justice Powell, Justice Douglas obviously had experience with securities law as a government regulator, but there's no one on the court now that has significant securities law work, any real work in this area beyond perhaps having represented a client on appeal, but no real work in the trenches in securities law. And that when you look at the distribution of decisions in the securities law decisions of the Roberts Court, you don't see any individual justice standing out as having staked out a particular interest or position on broader questions of securities law. The opinion assignment in securities law cases appears almost random. As Adam writes in his chapter, that it gets even more curious when you look at the substance of the opinions. He writes that one finds little effort to grapple with the relation between the financial markets and the securities laws. There are vigorous debates among the justices in some of these cases, but they revolve around questions of statutory interpretation and the relationship between the judiciary and the administrative state. The dominant theme is judicial modesty. You look in vain in these opinions for any broader discussion of the importance of securities law, broader questions of securities policy, how what the court is doing or is not doing conforms to some broader conception of what Congress has tried to do in this area. It's as almost as if the fact that these are securities law cases is incidental to the legal questions that are being discussed. And I find this observation that Adam makes particularly interesting because there are other areas of the law where we see the exact same thing in the Roberts Court. One that I've written a fair amount about is environmental law. With the exception of Justice Stevens' opinion, majority opinion in Massachusetts versus EPA, you cannot find a single majority opinion in an environmental case in the Roberts Court that expresses any degree of commitment or concern or particular insight onto the environmental context in which the case comes up. These cases, like the securities law cases, talk about statutory interpretation. They talk about administrative process. They talk about federalism. But the environment, not so much. And again, Justice Stevens' opinion in Massachusetts versus EPA is here an outlier. And you see something similar in the dissents in the environmental law cases. Again, with the exception of a few dissents written by Justice Stevens, like his Rapanos dissent, the dissents, again, focus on statutory interpretation, focus on questions of federalism, focus on questions of administrative process. But there are no kind of Justice Douglas-esque rhetorical flourishes about the importance of environmental concerns, no accusations that justices are engaged in slash and burn expeditions in particular fields quote a famous line from a Justice Blackmun dissent. The environmental context in which these cases arise is incidental, and it's interesting to see that pattern reemerge in the securities law area. It doesn't mean the cases aren't sometimes divided. It doesn't mean the justices don't have strong disagreements, but it is that the grounds of their disagreements aren't about the securities law questions and securities law policy questions. They're about when is it appropriate to find an implied cause of action? When is it appropriate to read statutory text in a particularly broad or narrow way? And something else that Adam notes in his chapter is that if the greatest kind of rhetorical exercises you find in securities law cases actually aren't even so much directed at each other among the justices, but are directed at lower courts. There are a handful of securities law opinions in the Roberts Court that are clearly aimed at saying to lower courts, cut it out, get in line. We don't want to have to deal with these outlying opinions that create unnecessary circuit splits. Get with the program. Stone Ridge, there's some language along these lines. But it's interesting, again, no use of rhetoric to make broader points about securities law and policy. Now, Adam postulates, and I think this is a provocative thing to think about, that the lack of any demonstrated concern for securities law or particular experience for securities law, he thinks has an impact on what cases the court selects. This is not an area like, say, the area of compulsory union dues, where you can see a series of cases certainly brought for strategic purposes by litigants and accepted by the court, I think one thinks, as a sequence driving towards a particular end. The pattern of cases in the union dues context certainly was leading towards a frontal challenge to the Abood decision. There is no pattern like that in the securities law cases. The court takes them because there's a circuit split. It doesn't take them because there's any broader securities law agenda that any of the justices have identified. And Adam postulates that this probably increases the importance of the Solicitor General's office, because the court, lacking any securities law expertise of its own, needs to look outside for cues about, well, is this really the right vehicle to resolve what appears to be a circuit split or resolve a question that is dividing lower courts? They don't have enough of a feel of their own for what might be the right vehicle, so they look for this external validation. The other point, I think, that comes out in the securities law cases, which I think is interesting to contrast with, say, the area of jurisdiction, where, as Andra pointed out, you do see the court being willing to make a dramatic break with prior case law, is that the securities law cases, especially when taken together, have a tremendous status quo bias. Despite the efforts of Justice Scalia, for example, the court has been unwilling to really cut back on, for example, implied causes of action that had been recognized in the Rehnquist or Berger courts. The court has basically said, well, if we've been letting you sue in these areas before, we'll continue to file similar suits. But at the same time, when lower courts have said, well, the logic of this of allowing litigation in one area might also seem to justify allowing a new avenue of litigation. So the court has likewise reinforced the status quo and said, no, we're not interested in that either. We really want to try and keep the litigation in this area within fairly narrow boundaries. And so, you know, you see this in the refusal to overturn BASIC, despite the fact that I think three justices had joined opinions suggesting that BASIC was, in their view, highly questionable, but no willingness to expand aider and abettor liability, or to allow for aider and abettor liability in a case like Stoneridge. It's very much a status quo bias, which again you do see in some other areas of the court's jurisprudence, but as Andra noted, there are areas like jurisdiction where you don't see it, and figuring out why we see such a strong status quo bias in some areas but not others, I think is certainly a puzzle worth pondering. I will stop there, and certainly we all look forward to questions and comments that you all have.
Okay, we have about 10 minutes for questions. Again, there are microphones going around the room here, so please, after you raise your hand, wait for the microphone. Actually, if there's no one jumping in, I can take the moderator's privilege here. I mean, one thing I'm struck by listening to the sort of range of topics that have been covered by this panel, is it possible to sort of reconcile the court's actions across these areas less by the idea that they have some pro-business bend and more as an expression of antipathy to the judiciary as a lawmaking body, and in particular as for class action litigation as a mode of regulation, and perhaps an antipathy that's so great that it overrides what is otherwise their antipathy for the regulatory state in the preemption context? I mean, is that one way of organizing these cases along a somewhat different axis than we've been talking about?
Yeah, I think that's right. You know, if there's any, and you can sort of chime in, but I'm think really in terms of seeing the you know, access. I mean, I sort of think about it as access to justice, but this idea of at least making that early on, that there is a move to make it harder, and I'm not sure where that's coming from, and that the mode seems to be that if you do have access to the court system, if you're able to clear those procedural hurdles, that there's merits determination earlier on, that there's more of a, there's more of sort of proving a sense of worthiness to be in the court system and to use the court system for resolving disputes. And I don't know if that comes from a notion of there's more frivolous litigation out there, or the courts are so, from a pragmatic point of view, the district courts are so hammered and inundated with case law that they just, we need to come up with alternative strategies, whether it's promoting settlement, promoting arbitration, or making the bar a little higher just to get court access, that something pragmatically needs to happen to deal with that, or conceptually that the court system is not the place for all of this litigation. So there may be a sense of there's, you know, it's being, the court system is being somehow misused and that there's abuse of the system. And maybe a sense that some of the litigation that's out there is not worthy or meritorious. So that's my gut instinct tells me that.
I'm loud enough. But Catherine, I was just curious, what do you think as far as the future of Chevron, and Jonathan, anybody, the future of Chevron deference? I mean, how important do you think the sex justice is the answer to that question?
Just for the sake of people watching the podcast, the question was, what is the future of Chevron? What do the panelists see as being the future of Chevron deference, and presumably our deference as well?
So I'm not a court prognosticator, although when I make predictions, I like to just be bold, because of course nothing turns on what Professor Sharkey says about any of these things. So, let me just say a quick thing, which is that I do have a position that I alluded to very quickly, just as a normative matter, what I would like to see. I think there are different forms of Chevron retreat. So for example, what I see the Chief Justice doing in the King case, which I know is very sui generis, et cetera, but saying this isn't a Chevron case at all, and the IRS isn't the right agency, is a kind of get the agency out of the picture type retreat. I see Michigan versus EPA, where under like Chevron's, what's known as Chevron Step 2, the court is giving a lot more scrutiny to what is reasoned decision-making by the agency. I like that form of retreat, as I like the idea of judicial scrutiny over agencies to reasoned decision-making. I think that it can prompt the agency into doing a better job, however we're gonna describe better and what its job is. So that's what I'd like to see. In terms of predicting, I can't imagine, I think Chevron is here to stay. What Chevron means, there have been periods of its sort of ebb and flow. I do think we'll see some, what will look like a kind of restriction on it, but I'm hoping that it's of the latter form, not the punting agencies out of the question. And the last thing I just say in response to your question is, it's a little too easy, I think, to say, okay, we don't want courts making up policy, because in a lot of these administrative law areas, if they get rid of the agency and Congress hasn't been clear and is dysfunctional, isn't doing anything, then that'll just leave the court. So the other thing that I like about my model is it kind of harnesses information from the agency and also forces the agency into doing reasoned decision making, which will help the courts do their job deciding cases. So I like that, and I'd like to think we're moving into that realm.
Really briefly, Chevron, I agree Chevron's here to stay, but what Chevron means is will be contested. Our deference, I don't know, I mean, there are three justices that have questions about it. And so I think it's certainly at least up for grabs. The one thing that I think makes this particularly difficult is that administrative law is one of those areas where a handful of justices have strong commitments. Scalia certainly did. He's no longer on the court. Chief Justice Roberts has some strong commitments about viewing Chevron in a way that doesn't aggrandize agency power. I think his Arlington dissent, which I think you see revived in King versus Burwell, is that Justice Breyer has some administrative law commitments that I don't think are doctrinal in nature. I mean, I think they're more in the nature of how he thinks decision-making should occur, wherever it occurs. Justice Kagan has some doctrinal commitments in this area, both based on some of her opinions and some of her academic scholarship, which have a very different view on Chevron than, for example, the Chief Justice has. She's not really worried about agency aggrandizement. She, in some respects, might even like it in some contexts, the way an early Justice Scalia viewed it as so much preferable to what Justice Scalia feared was judicial aggrandizement. And you know, the rest of the justices, I don't really think have really strong commitments in this area. And so a lot's going to depend on what the cases are and kind of how the justices that do have commitments are able to frame the questions. Because, you know, Justice Ginsburg, there are certain issues she cares a lot about. How to conceive of Chevron doctrine and how that theory of Chevron deference should inform when it is or is not appropriate. That's just not something she's focused on. Ditto with, you know, several of the other justices. And that makes it hard because you're not really sure how to count. So just last thing on that, in the King versus Burwell majority, the parts of that opinion that are about Chevron, I think clearly the Chief Justice believed, maybe Kennedy believed, because they arguably draw on a prior Kennedy opinion in the Oregon litigation on doctor-assisted suicide. The other justices that were in the King majority, I'm pretty sure they signed on because the Chief Justice was reaching the outcome they wanted. They weren't gonna waste their time splitting hairs on two paragraphs in the opinion about administrative law. And so are they along for the ride the next time you get a case like that? I don't think we have really any idea.
Okay, we're just about at time, and it's time for the lunch break. Thank you to our panelists for a great discussion. We have a 15-minute break right now, so we'll be returning at a quarter to. There are boxed lunches in the room across the hall from the doors here. So see you all in 15 minutes.